guys, and welcome back to another Unfiltered Gamer board game review. Today's game up on the tabletop is called This is Heroes of Land, Sea, and Air by Gamelin Games, which they make a lot of tiny epic stuff, but this one is not tiny. However, it is epic. In the game Heroes of Land, Sea, and Air, you play from 1 to 4 players with the caveat that you can play 5, 6, and even 7 players with the Order and Chaos and Pestilence expansions, along with a bunch of extra little mini expansions included. This is a 4X game, which means you need to do 1 of 4 things to end the game. One being explore, one being exploit, one being expand, and the other being exterminate. And once one of those 4 things happen, the game ending will trigger. You're trying to score points by moving around a board, destroying people, building things, acquiring new units, placing things on the board, and looking through the different areas on the continent to gather certain resources and all other kinds of goodies. This game is a large game with a ton of content, which we're going to go ahead and show you right now, and then we'll talk about it. So as you can see, this is Heroes of Land, Sea, and Air, and there is a lot to talk about. I'm going to try and be brief with every little bit, but just give you an overview of what the entire thing is. Luckily, if you want, I think... Shut Up and Sit Down, or somebody did a really, really good playthrough of this explanation, and I'll go ahead and put it down in the link below if you want a full detailed explanation. Watch It Played. That's who did it. If you want a full detailed explanation of how to play the game, Watch It Played is your best bet. But if you want to know what I think about the game, as well as a very decent overview, you can keep watching. Anyway, so this is Heroes of Land, Sea, and Air. And as you can see, I've got everything out here. We've got the Order and Chaos expansion, the Pestilence, player boards, additional mercenary pack expansions, the boost boxes, we've got little siege engines, as well as all of the 10 character classes and the character boards associated. Over there are all of the different miniatures. Really, on this board here is just one single class with all of their stuff, and generally speaking, this is not even near enough space to play an entire 7-player game. This is the base box, which plays 1 to 4 players with the single player variant. This is the main board of the game right here, and then this over here is the expanded player board. What you're going to do is you're going to put them together, look at the top left hand corner, and if it's 1 to 4 player game, you flip it over, and if it's 5 to 6 player game, you have it on this side. Bottom right left hand side over there is resources. You take the 3, the red, the green, and the yellow, you mix them up in your hand, and you toss them down on the 4, 3, and 2 space. Everybody who's playing is going to get one of those little tokens in the corner there, and you're going to place your victory point marker right underneath it, I guess, on the 0 point tracker, which is going to go up on this track here. Once it gets to 50, you can actually flip it over and keep going, and that's going to score you more points. Get all your characters, all your miniatures, and put them somewhere around your board, as well as your 3 towers, and then your capital city structures. Take these 2, and or 3 technically, set them aside. Get 1 spell card from the spell deck, which are really small cards, as well as your action tokens, which look like shields based on the specific racing class you're using. It's going to have a specific symbol, that's what you're going to use. The youngest player is going to get the starting player token, just set it on their board somewhere, as well as everybody is going to get the same 3 resources from over there, put them on their board on 2. You're going to start with 2 of each of the 3 resources. You're going to get 3 specific character heroes that all have their own abilities, and you're going to set them aside as well, just like you would the rest of your units. The board here is going to have 1 gray token on each of the land spaces, except for any place in which a player is placing a capital, and any swamp area is going to have 2. And you don't place them on the circles. The circles don't go on the circles. They just go on the area. Units are going to go in the circles, so just as a note. Additionally, if you're playing with the avians or the bird faction, you can include this territory here. You're going to align it as it is explained in the rules, and then you're also going to place things just like you normally would. This is usually, in fact, when you're playing with either avians or when you're playing with 7 total players. This little mat over here is for the merfolk, and basically merfolk, whenever they choose a specific location, they're going to place their player board down there, and then they're going to set their capital city down there as well. Merfolk start there, and this water area here can never go on the avian area, and if the avians ever want the avian area first, they're going to get it. Additionally, each of the water areas on the board are marked, and they have little lines. You're going to place a water marker token, the little circular water ones, place them down in each area along with 2 in each of the big main areas of the board. That's basically going to be your explore aspect. Once all of those are discovered, that would trigger one of the explore actions of the game, which would trigger the ending of the game, in which a couple rounds would continue, and that would be the end of it. Another way to end the game is by placing all of these towers, 1 on each of the different continents, because you can't place them on the same continent. it, that would trigger the game end, as well as if you manage to defeat somebody's capital city, that would also trigger a game end. And the last one is if you can get all of your units on the board, that would trigger the game end. Let's go ahead and talk about the player actions and how it's going to basically function. So basically, you're going to get the first starting player, if he starts with a little token here, is going to get one of these boards here, and you're going to go ahead and look at it. And if you look at it, everything on the left-hand side is your capital city area. You start with level 1, and anything that's in level 1 is going to be a bonus to that specific area. If you upgrade to level 2, you'll get level 1 and level 2 bonuses. If you get to level 3, you'll get all of them, provided that you own that specific building. In order to pick up these characters here, these are all the specific units you have. You're going to have serfs, warriors, your three specific champions, your raft, and your beetle, or depending on what your air and your water vessel are, is what they're going to be called. But in order to pick these guys up, you'll have to also have these specific buildings corresponding. So to get these specific abilities, you'll have to have this space, along with this specific warrior, you'll have to have this space. And that is the basic idea of them. So we'll go over the different actions and whatnot. This is your resource tracker, and this is where you're going to hold spell cards that you want to utilize from turn to turn, as opposed to just burning them. Recruit. Recruit's very simple. On your turn, you're going to get to basically place your little action tokens, which are these guys here, and you place it on one of the spaces that you want, any of the spaces up here. If you place your action token on any of these spaces over here, people can choose to follow you, which means following is if anybody else has a serf or a worker bee, basically they can place, if they have one here, they can place it over here on the same space you've chose after you've placed it to follow your action. Now, they don't have to do the exact same action. As long as it's recruit, they can choose to recruit anybody. They have to do the same action, but they don't have to choose the same specific thing you do. So if I wanted to recruit, I could then purchase any of these here. These are all the units you can recruit. There is a cost to them associated at the bottom here, and they tell you, and every one of them you can only purchase one of, except for when you're buying the serfs or the workers, you can buy one for one, or you can buy two units for three. But otherwise, you just buy one for one, as long as you meet the requirements. Everybody else can choose to follow you, and after that is done, then the next player is going to get to take their action. This is build. Build is simple. There are three things you can build. Technically, there's three things you can build. You got these guys here, which is going to cost you one red crystal for each space away from your capital. It is, and you can place those down, and that's how you can win the game. And then you can also purchase upgrades to your tower. So you're going to start with the base one, which is over here. And if you wanted to purchase this next one, it'll cost you the next space up. You always start with level one, though. But the next one is like 4, 4, and 4, and then 7, 7, and 7. And that's how you can get all your abilities. And I think those are the main two buildings, technically. You can build these specifically, but you have to complete these. Oh, these are also buildings too, I suppose. It's going to be three red plus placing one of your serfs on here. So if I wanted to, I could spend my action on the build. I could take my dude, place it on one of these circles over here, and then I would have to pay three red, and I would own this specific building. So this is the ziggurat, this is the voodoo hut, thieves den, in which would give me all the passive abilities based on my capital city, as well as being able to purchase and or recruit the unit that is down beneath it. So these guys will go there. That's pretty useful, right? Next thing you could do is research or scribe. Research is going to let you draw cards from the deck, which are the spell cards over there. Or you can take a specific type of card and place it based on the level of capital. If you got level 1 capital, you'll place it on the level 1 area. If you got level 2, you can place it on either of these two. You'll have both spaces to utilize, and so on and so forth. But you'll place it there, in which you can utilize at a certain point, and then once you used it, you have to turn it to the side, and it's going to refresh after a period of time, in which case you'll be able to utilize it again. Otherwise, you can go ahead and choose to tax. And taxing is pretty simple. You look at that board down there, and right now we get a 4 yellow, a 3 green, and a 2 red. If I choose to tax, I might want 4 yellow, in which case I'm going to move the yellow down and everything up. So whatever one you choose, you're gonna go ahead and move the board exactly in like a clockwise manner. So if I chose 3 green, it would move yellow down, it would move green up. In which case, everybody else can follow you as well, but they're gonna follow you on the exact action. So nothing will move until everybody is done deciding whether they want to follow or not. After those actions, you could also choose command actions. And command actions cannot be followed, but they can be mustered. In which case, let's say I wanted to use one of my actions on here, I could take my little peon, and I could go ahead and muster to do an extra action. So for instance, if I wanted to march, I could take all of my units and move them based on the lowest space available to the unit in the group. So if you got three dudes with two movement, but there's one dude with one. That entire group can only move one space if you take him along. But if I chose to do that once, I could also take one of my serfs and place it on the secondary march action, because there's two, and then I could march again. So that's how mustering works. So the next thing is sailing, which is you can sail a boat that starts at your capital city, and you can move around the board based on its movement. Flying is specific to flying vehicles that function just like march and sail. And cast is going to allow you to cast spells with the trait cast on them. And those are all the basic actions you can do. The only other thing that's unique and takes a bit of explaining is, luckily I've got this little chart here, is battling. When you march units onto another player's area that has units, a battle instantly ensues. And when that happens, you're going to tally up all the power of that specific unit, and it tells you on the board what, how much power that your unit has. And you're going to tally up all of their power, take any active abilities or anything like that that you have, and add that together. And then after that, each player can cast a combat spell with the starting with the defending player. So they can play one of those cards, then I can play one of the cards if I want. And then after that, you can select a tactic. And tactics are these over here. Everybody gets the same 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 cards. And basically each player can play them down, but they have a cost on them in the top left-hand corner. At the bottom, they're going to have victory points that you just gain for playing them. And in addition, they are going to give you a certain amount of damage at the top, as well as they will say something special like rock, paper, scissors style. If I play First Strike and you played Conscripts, well, unfortunately for you, First Strike cancels Conscripts, which actually will stop this card from being active. But they all do different things. Siege is going to be a really strong card and also gets +1 to certain things. Conscripts will let you bring more dudes in. Barricade is good for playing if you're the defender. Fight is just a 0, so it's kind of like a bluff card. Retreat lets you move your units away, charge, and First Strike, right? If you want, of course, you can choose to retreat. And if you don't, you're going to, after you go ahead and choose this thing here, you're going to resolve the battle. And based on the player who loses, they're going to take their damage divided by half and lose that many units. And because each unit can only be dealt one damage, they only need to be dealt one damage to die, you want to try and soak up as much damage as you possibly can to do the best job at keeping your forces alive. So if you got three guys that are worth two and one guy worth one, and you're dealt one damage, you want to do the one damage to the one. Because if a two is dealt one damage, it still dies regardless. So I hope that that makes a little sense. And after that, also if you battle, you get a point, straight up, as well as when you play cards and when you play spell cards. So battling can get you a boatload of points. But that's the basic idea. After that, they have to be returned. Whoever loses has to be returned to the capital city. You're never going to have two factions of the same, of a different color on the same space, and you can never have more than 5 units in a singular space. So be aware that you have a specific limit as to how many you have. And there's also some additional rules involving if you can't afford to cast certain things like tactics and whatnot, you can choose to sacrifice your units, even though they'll still be added to the total tally at the end. They're just going to have to be removed regardless of whether you win or not. So there's a little bit of bluffing, a little bit of choosing, sacrificing or not, playing, casting spells. This is a whole flowchart for attacking. It's not actually as complicated as it probably sounds, but nevertheless, that's how you do it. Once one of the four conditions that I talked about before is triggered, I think there's 2 more rounds to the game, in which case you're just going to try and gather as many points as possible. Another thing to note is when you're moving around the board as you walk and as you land on specific spaces, you're going to basically be able to do these explore tokens, and they have a huge reference of all the different things that happen. When you land on space, you'll take that little token off that space, and you're going to be triggering specific things that will do certain things. A sea serpent, that's not good, right? What's gonna happen? Maybe it'll help you, maybe it will not help you whatsoever. Additionally, after everybody has taken their 2 actions, that's gonna go, I take an action, you, and it's gonna go around because we only have 2 actions apiece, and you can choose to use your serfs to follow or to move onto the board and whatnot, then it's going to have a cleanup step, and I don't know, it's somewhere around here, there's a bunch of stuff going on with this stuff, but it tells you how the cleanup section, I'll remove all the serf tokens, blah, 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 blah. First player passes clockwise, and you'll score certain resources based on the serfs that you have on the board. The circular space on the board is where you can place serfs. In general, when you have a character on the board somewhere, like for instance, if I have it on the green area here, I'm going to get a green at the end of the round. But if I have a serf, and it's also attached to a circle that's on a green area, I'll get an additional resource. But it's only good for one, for each one on each circle. So for instance, in this case, I would get 2 green. That's how it works. So getting as many guys as you can on the board, it's going to be helpful as far as gathering resources. You'll probably have to tax less. And getting these characters over here is going to give you specific passives for each of the different classes. All the classes have different things going on for them. They also have all of their own unique flying ships, as well as their own boats, as well as their own towers and their own capital cities. The boards are both front and back when it comes to solo player modes, as well as when it comes to the giant crazy player modes. The game takes probably about, I want to say, at least 3 hours for a decent 4 or 5 player game, and probably add an extra half an hour per player. It's a typical 4X game. It looks bright and vibrant, but there's a lot going on in this game. That's the basic idea for what you need to know. Complete one of the 4Xs, and then score as many points as possible, and there's a ton of ways of scoring points in this game. Let's go ahead and now go over here, move away from all the stuff, and let me tell you what I think about it. So there you have Galen Games' Heroes of Land, Sea, and Air. This is definitely by far their largest game and their most epic, in my opinion. I like the Tiny Epic series. I've played 3 of them now, and they're all good fun. I think there's a good reason as to why they're so successful. This one here has so much going for it, and it's so big. It shows such a table presence. I got to see it at Origins, and just looking at the entire felt map, I was like, oh, I want that instead of my board because it looks even cooler. That's because the game just looks cool. But is it cool? Yes, it's very, very cool. All the races are very unique to themselves. They all have their own special things. Everything about each of the races is pretty much individual. There's nothing similar about any of them. Even some of them, like the undead, will allow you to steal souls from the board. And when you defeat certain players, you're going to be able to gather souls and utilize those souls for bonus attack damage, as well as costing you less or reviving the dead. Humans are going to be more useful as, like, I don't know, collecting resources. And then you've got stuff like the dwarves who can build stuff. You got the avians who are able to fly around better. There's a lot. The merfolk have their own literal water space that turns the board into water. They went all out with this. Now, this is very reminiscent to some of the Tiny Epic games as to how it plays, but it adds a lot more to it. And the fact that there's 4 different conditions to end the game is very interesting, because you might not be going for the same one that somebody else is going for. This is not necessarily a fighting game. Now, of course, with more players comes a little bit more room for a little bit more attacking, but not necessarily it's going to be all the time. It's just when it happens, there are some really epic battles. The fact that the fighting isn't just simply checking to see and rolling some dice, what actually is happening is you're placing them down, you're going to be doing cards, choosing bluffs, you're going to be choosing to do tactics, and you're going to be able to spend units to sacrifice in order to win, because certain points are very, very pivotal in this game. Really, really, really cool action fighting aspect of the game. Building is very interesting as well, where you want to place, how you want to place, and it's more of the looming threat of somebody coming in and taking you out, because you might think you're pretty far from somebody, but in 1 or 2 rounds, they can all be on top of you. You never want to be too far ahead, in my opinion. You always want to be just straddling the line up until that very end point where you score a bunch of points. Winning battles doesn't mean you're going to win either. You want to score points, and yes, winning battles will make people basically slump them off, but that doesn't necessarily mean you're going to score as many points as them. If I play a spell card worth 3 victory points, and I play a tactic worth 2, that's 5 points for me, whereas the other player who attacked me only gets 1 point. Maybe they didn't have any resources to spend, so they didn't get to play any cards to gain any victory points, and so they beat me, but they're still 5 points behind me now, and they gave me points to go ahead. You gotta be very tactical in your decision-making skills. The turns are long, and there's some room for analysis paralysis in this game, because there's so many things that you can choose to do in the game, when really, there's only 4 things that you can do as far as main actions, and then there's the moving around and casting spells. That's really how it works. If you look at one of these boards here, I'm just gonna go and swoop this thing off. This board here, it's literally just recruiting units, building buildings, researching and scribing is just gathering spells or placing them over here, and taxing is going on the board and gathering a resource based on the track and how it moves. That is the main 4 things you're doing. The rest of the stuff is just how you want to move your units around and what type of battles you want to do, and then when you want to cast certain spells. And there's actually a good amount of spells, especially when you get into the expansion content. They give you a good chunk, and you're never going to probably have, you get at the end of every round, you also get like 1 spell and whatnot. There's a cleanup phase that gives you additional resources and spells, and you move the tracker and the first player marker along, but you probably have maybe 10-15 cards throughout the entire game, depending on how many actions you want to gather. But they are very useful. Some of them are combat cards, some of them are going to be more of interrupts, They got all kinds of different things as how they're focused on those casts that we put on your board, and you can turn them, and you can constantly use them over and over again. And every time you cast a spell, it's going to be worth victory points. So casting spells is very, very important in the game, as well as, of course, tactics. That's really relevant as well. At the end of the game, there's a bunch of scoring bonuses, too, based on where your units are, based on your board. Every specific character's player has specific bonus victory points. Each plains region you control at the end of the game is worth an additional one victory point. There's also the area, little guys here, these things. Some of them, when you flip them over, they're like, oh, these are eggs. Put them in your tower. And now if anybody takes that tower, they get the eggs. At the end of the game, eggs are worth 2 points. So it's like, oh, now there's a specific objective I need to accomplish. It's among not only just the main four, but also these eggs are going to score me a boatload of points if I can gather enough and put them in my towers. But it also makes me a target. There is going to be specifically some picking on of the weaker players. If you have a poor position in the game, you're going to be targeted. So for those of you with the faint of heart, it'll be you're going to want to play as passive and political as possible. If you don't like long games, this is not going to be for you either. It is lengthy. There's a lot to set up. And even when you're playing even a two-player game, it's going to take you, I'd say, 30 to 45 minutes to set up completely. And then it'll take you maybe a two-player game, an hour and a half, depending on how fast you are playing the game. With me, I'm a big thinker, so things take longer. But overall, this game is beautiful. This game has beautiful components. The setup is relatively easy once you've done it the first time. I didn't have to like look at the rules all that much to figure out what needed to go where, even with putting up basically a 7-player board, minus all the extra players and stuff. And I guess the only other small critique I have is you have to put together all the towers and all the capitals and all the airships and boats, but I think instead of doing what I do, you should remedy that by simply each player has to put together their own thing when you play the game. Makes it a lot easier. This game gets my seal of approval, hands down. It was an excellent epic adventure and one I want to partake in again. Even though I lost miserably, I really, really enjoyed this game. And I just enjoyed playing with everybody around me and the craziness that ensued.